Edfu Foundation Incorporated utilizes science and the teachings of our ancestors to improve humanity. We want to reunite and uplift our family throughout the planet. Our message or theme for 2021 is Original People United. We work hand in hand with our sister organization, the Conservancy Corp, investing in the future of humanity through our programs and advocacy. We seek to move our civilization from its current state to that of a Type 1 civilization on the Kardashev civilization scale and beyond in a spiritually holistic way. We stand by the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Durban Declaration, and Program of Action, and support United Nations 17 Sustainable Development Goals and Environment Justice. Support EFFU Foundation by checking out our page and subscribing.
We're in this field. I was in an interview with Stephen Barnes and Tasha Womack the other day for the Hampton Film Festival, and we were asking a question about film, and it's just, that's obviously where everything is going. I mean, I've done this book. It's going to be eventually, you know.
I would rather see it be an anime, because like reading the book, I mean, it's fantastical. I mean, it's wonderful. Like you said, it shows on the birth of the universe to like going like way, way in the future. And I think, I mean, that's just my personal opinion, is like, right. I think film is great, but I mean, people poo-poo on anime, but there's a certain sense of style and elements that you can't do in a film. That's just not, you know what I mean? It's not practical, right?
And yeah, so some things— it's vice versa though, you know what I mean? If I see a real guy doing this, you know what I mean? I'm gonna feel like more attached to it if they can show me it in a realistic type of way. I'm gonna be blown away, you know what I mean? If you can show me the beginning of the universe and I'm in it and I'm actually doing it, you know what I mean? It's gonna be like, wow.
Right. Well, I'm just saying, like you know, I mean, they have CGI, right? Soul, right, from Pixar, like, you know, they have ways. They just did the Raya, right? Raya was like crazy, like futuristic.
That's
in a
nice,
sense.
That's nice, but it's still that wall of me.
Mugnito's like, Mugnito hates cartoons. That's what it is.
No, I love, I'm Mugnito. Half of my name came from Magneto. What are you talking about? I love cartoons, you know what I mean? I love comic books.
I would say this, it's like Eric, the Montemagri, right?
Yeah, the live action, yes.
Yeah, I mean, the comics are great. It's something when you see that live action.
Yes, it is. That is true.
I love comics. I do it for a living, but yes, it's just something when you see that live action project.
If they do it right, it's going to be awesome.
The 2D versus the 3D. You know what I mean? It's the flat image.
There you go.
Versus
there you
the 3D go. Of the image coming go. At you, going at you, and all that type of stuff.
Yeah, exactly. That's lessons right there from the director right there, letting us know, like, hey, my craft. Well, let me school y'all on what you really are trying to say.
It's the comic books we grew up on in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It's people embracing these stories because they could see real people in it versus the stories that we all read that growing up that they've kind of altered or changed or kind of fit in. You know what I mean? That WandaVision, how many different mental tangents did people think every little image was going off on? And none of them paid out. It was just, it was a story about grief and a love story. You know, in the comic book, the 2D, you would just read the story. You wouldn't think all these other images, or if it was in there, you would think it. But in seeing it in 3D, our mind just kept pulling all these different, that must mean this and that must mean that. And, you know, and none of it meant anything. So
that leads me to another question. Since you brought up Marvel Cinematic Universe, and, you know, Tim, and this question is for Eric, and Tim, you know, feel free to chime in. But Legend of Montajabi, what led you to, like, you're a director, you're doing well, 3 NAACP, or wait, almost a 4th NAACP Image Award coming up, Emmy, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, what made you, like, hey, I want to do a graphic novel, a comic book?
It's simple. We love Black Panther, but how often did we see Black Panther? It was never really prominent growing up. The movie did more probably than the series, or Black Lightning, a failed comic book. And I mean, it's a great TV show. It lasted 1 year in 1977 when everybody was buying comic books. So
the only black guy that I gave credit to back in the day was Luke Cage. So
was everything to me. Loved him. But he wasn't saving the world. He was saving the neighborhood. And I go see a James Bond movie, he's saving the world. I, I go see, you know, it Raiders of the Lost Ark. He's saving the world. Like, I just wanted to see us saving the world. And it's been that, it was Afrofuturism before there's Afrofuturism. So it was always a lifetime goal on it. What was interesting, when I sat down to do the book, it was kind of like storyboarding to me. So it was just another form of that 10,000 hours I always talk about directing. And then, you know, I got to do the book. And to think about it, in the time that I've done the book, we've had Luke Cage on TV. We've had Black Lightning on TV, and we had Black Panther in the movies, and that's it. Huh?
We had Mantis.
But Mantis. Mantis.
Hey, don't forget about Will Smith. Now he is
a universal
champion. That's whether that's aliens or superheroes, whatever it is, we got Will.
That's all we had. But think about it. Both Mantis and the Will Smith movie that he did, they didn't even go pick all. So finally got two Black things that could be hero. They made them up. Anything of all the things we had, why wasn't Will playing Black Panther? Why wasn't Will playing Luke Cage? Why wasn't Will playing Black Lightning? They just went and made them up. Like, there was nothing that they saw it and was like, you have to give Bob Iger and you have to give Kevin Feige a lot of credit, because they were never gonna make Black Panther. It was always just a hit and a hit and a hit. And it was Bob Iger that said, no, we're actually gonna do this. And Kevin Feige made it happen. Like, they literally were just gonna do, you know, have him pop in movies like they did some of the other characters and never get his own movie. And they're like, no, we're gonna do it. Found an amazing director. And if you remember all the articles, when the movie was done, they even gave him more money to go back and do some more in it, because they said it's close, but we need to add something else. So they gave him another $25 million to go do it. They were
In their defense, though, I would have to say, they really didn't have enough, I don't know, so history of Black people investing in that area.
When there's nothing there, what do you?
Well, hold on, I gotta say this. Blade is what saved Marvel.
Yeah.
Blade was something different because it was a vampire movement at that time. It was, everybody was on vampires. It did. Of course, he was going to blow up. You know what I mean? Of course.
But was there preference? Listen. You don't need preference. If you have a community, listen, Tyler Perry should have been enough to make them want to make five Black. Every time Tyler makes a movie, he makes a profit, right?
Yeah, but I'm talking about come on now, come on now, y'all. Now, if I go to my father and be like, hey, Dad, you going to see the next X-Men movie? You know what I mean? He won't be looking at me crazy. He just done this before. He didn't told me he just can't get into that. He wasn't born in that era, you know? So it wasn't like a prep for us, for the executives to be like, you know what, we're gonna get him $100,000 to do Black Panther. I'm not gonna put that pressure on them.
I 1,000% disagree, because statistically, Blacks and Hispanics see more movies than anybody else, yet we are the
movies, but not Marvel. Marvel just blew up, bro. I mean, no. I was on Marvel for since it created. I was just a nerd.
I'm sorry, really? I have to disagree with you 1,000% on all of this.
Oh, no.
I'm telling you.
No,
they
man.
Mook. Eric works in Hollywood, man. I mean,
I understand, but show me a movie. I'm talking about real life. I'm talking about, you know, like I say, people I know, bro. Nobody was on what I was on in my neighborhood.
But they seen Blade, right?
That was a vampire movie.
This is why they couldn't be on it, because we wasn't in it. There was nothing in it for them.
That's what I'm saying. But you can't draw off nothing and think that, okay, this is going to be a blockbuster movie. You know, they're not going to have that fore vision, what I'm saying. I'm not saying it's right, but they're not going to have that fore vision if they ain't seen.
You're thinking blockbuster is all-time large movie. I'm talking about they never should have made Crazy Rich Asians. They never should have made, in your mind.
All of those movies was not demands, though, bro. Those was...
They were 100% demands.
No, there wasn't demand. That was people using their genius to put it on people. And then, like, then the people say, okay, that's genius. And then it became a demand. But it was a demand before it happened.
I disagree with you 1,000%. All the minorities are underserved. The demand.
We underserved, but they not going to know that. How we going to know that? How they going to know that? That's what I'm saying.
Let me finish the sentence. Because if you interrupt every word, you're not going to hear everything I'm saying. So let me finish the sentence. All of these minorities have dying for entertainment that represents them. Hollywood is, every exec is basically not Black, not Asian. They're basically white. All the decision makers in all the rooms. All the statistics show that every time you invest in one of these movies that are all a Tyler Perry movie, any movie, they make a huge profit, more so than any other movie that they spend $150 or $250 million on. So it's negligence, because they could have said, hey, I'm not going to spend $200 on Black Panther, but I'll make it for $100 and it will make money. I may not spend $300 on Crazy Rich Asians, but I'm going to make it for this amount and make money. I'm telling you right now, that's why they're doing it now. You can't say there was no demand when only one people are making the product. There's 100% been a demand, but not everybody's making the product. Like, to prove my point, look at all those great Marvel actors in all those movies. How many of them can open a movie outside of a Marvel movie? Very few of them.
They right? can't even, the Black Widow, they got to keep pushing that back because they're like, right. she can't carry it.
So we've come to the point where we are making these diverse movies like Crazy Rich Asians, like Black Panther, like all these things. It's there, it's time, it's long overdue, and that's why these movies are exploding so much. But to say there's no example of them to do it, that's not true. There was always examples of them to do it. They were just under the misnomer that, well, why would we do it? Also, the last thing I'll say on that is, those executives, they're still creative people. They wanna see things that they're interested in. So if you only have one race in a room making decisions, there's no rush for them to make those type of movies because that's not what interests them, because that's culturally not their thing.
So, and to your point, Eric, where's the demand for Sharknado? They made four of those movies, right? They throw money down the toilet on movies that you're like, why did they even make that? Like, I just lost an hour of my life, like, watching it, right? They throw this money down the toilet. And so why would you not give the chance to an underserved community that may turn up and show out and support the movie? You know what I'm saying?
You're not black. Well, brother, you're not black. You're white. You know what I mean? If you, of course, I'm a invest in my brother. You know what I mean? If I see, okay, he got a little something going, you know, whatever. But I'm not gonna look over to the white person to say, you know what? I'm gonna take.
No. What I'm saying is, it becomes
a and make this little change. You know what I mean? You're gonna do that if you're white. You know what I mean?
It becomes the old boys club.
Exactly, bro. That's what it is.
I hear everything, but this is my take on it. Coming from a family of filmmakers and understanding the impact of digital technology, I understand that in the previous mode, pre-streaming, there's some truth to that. But now that we have arrived in the streaming scenario, what has happened is that you can only make so many variations on the same thing. So you have to begin to expand out in terms of the type of stories that you have to tell. Now, you then drop COVID in that, where people are going through 10 years worth of library content, all these streaming services. And when I say streaming services, that's just a term, but we're really talking about the major studios. So yes, Paramount Plus is a streaming service, but it's really Paramount Pictures. So all of the libraries they built over the decades, they can put that online. The problem is COVID has allowed people to go through decades of material in 10 months. So they're forced now to continually try to generate new content. Plus, when you send these huge, huge things, Disney Plus, Apple, kind of come together, what's happening is they're soaking up a lot of the talent and they're consolidating quite a bit of the content that's already in existence. So now all of a sudden, Netflix can't get the Marvel shows because Marvel has their shows on Disney Plus. So this is both a disadvantage to the companies, but it is absolutely a boon for people who are of color, who are creators. And it's a boon, frankly, for the audience, because I mean, my book's going to be turned into a movie. Not only is Infinite going to be turned, it's going to be Infinite will probably be a series. Maddie's Rocket might be a series or a movie. I'm not just saying this because, I believe it. It's the time.
They're looking for content. They need that content. They want that market.